Wednesday Night Hoops from the Farrell Center in Waco, Texas, as 22nd ranked Baylor takes on the TCU Horned Frogs. The house lights down, and we welcome you in courtside at the Farrell Center. And the lights come back up as we show you what's going on in the Big 12. In Morgantown last night, Kansas falls to West Virginia, so the Mountaineers the only unbeaten in conference play. Baylor looking to tie KU in the standings with a win here tonight, and TCU looking for conference win number two. Along with former Oklahoma State point guard Brendan Manzer, I'm Mark Dealey. Both these teams coming off wins on Saturday. TCU by a point over Texas and Fort Worth. And how about Baylor? They win in Ames for the second straight year over Iowa State. And Lester Medford was fantastic. The most impressive part of his line, 11 assists, no turnovers.
Unbelievable. Hey, you don't go to three Sweet 16s in 6 years without excellent point guard play. And this season, in steps Lester Medford. Number one, as you alluded to, Mark, ball security. He's got good vision, gets his teammates involved as well. But here's the icing on the cake. Just like point guards in the past for Scott Drew, Medford so too can score. He's been terrific here as of late.
Well, the breaking news on the guard side for TCU is Malik did not make the trip due to a violation of team rules. How does that affect the Horned Frogs here?
Well, TCU's depth is at the 3, 4, and 5 position, and they don't have much in the backcourt. So expect Chauncey Collins, Michael Williams, and Brandon Parrish to log heavy minutes tonight. Look late for them. They've got to take care of the ball against this team the entire game, but particularly late in the game when they get tired, they're going to really have to focus with Trent being gone here tonight.
Look at the lineups again. You notice no Trent. Chris Washburn in for the second straight game starting. He had the game-winning shot, game-winning block shot to beat Texas. And for Baylor, Lester Medford, we just talked about him, six consecutive double-figure scoring games. And Torian Prince has just been fantastic this year. The sixth man of the year a year ago, starting this year, and he's been terrific.
Mark, both these teams feeling good about themselves after their performances Saturday. And this 18-game grind of the Big 12 Conference, I mean, it is an emotional roller coaster.
And we're just getting going with that roller coaster. Baylor in the home white, TCU in the road purple. We are underway from Waco.
One of the great things about Baylor, much like last year, is the ball does not stick. They share it, all five guys, in a great way.
And Ish Wainwright called for an offensive foul.
Wainwright right there forcing his will. Not much ball movement. Now, Wainwright's been really good for Scott Drew. Solid at both ends of the floor. Coming into his own this year in Waco.
Well, the Horned Frogs, here's Chauncey Collins, Williams, Sinanet, the Shepherd. Shot over that zone. Bouncing around and in for Kavar Shepherd.
Kind roll right there for the visitor. Usually you don't get that on the road, but you see where TCU wants to get the ball against this zone. They want to get the ball flat, meaning along the baseline, and they go twice to Shepherd there in the short corner.
Yeah, Brendan, TCU's going to have to hit some of those perimeter shots to have a chance on the road here tonight.
Well, much like when you play West Virginia, Baylor forces you to make plays from the perimeter because of the zone defense that they throw at you most of the time.
Medford, some great moves, couldn't quite finish though with the shot off the back rim. You know, Baylor last year played zone a good 90-plus percent of the time. They're much more balanced with their man-to-man and zone defense. But with TCU tonight, we may see that zone percentage go up.
That's because TCU takes the least amount of threes in the Big 12 Conference.
Shepherd that time short, and it's tipped and controlled by Lester Medford.
And that's a great point, Mark, because TCU on the offensive end, they're going to run their stuff and try to get those touches on the interior.
Gathers almost lost it, but able to tip it, keep it alive with Al Freeman, and then that's punched by Shepherd. Shot clock gets to 10. Medford. Prince going to shoot a three. Rebound, Gathers doing what he does so well. Tried to go to the bucket, but was stripped by Kavar Shepherd.
And good recovery by Shepherd, because as we've seen throughout his career here at Baylor, Rico Gathers on that weak side. I mean, he's immovable. Had a lane to the basket, but good hands.
Coming over to block that time, Prince. Wainwright!
Scott Drew talked to you and I today that they want to get one and dones. And without question, that was a one and done, and they want to push the basketball. But what you saw right there is Taurean Prince, who is one of the complete players in this league. He affects every phase of the game in a positive way. He did with the block.
That's a two-point shot for Shepard, so he's hit both field goals for TCU. The authoritative dunk for Wainwright, the only point so far for Baylor.
That's great to see. Shepard has extended his range this year. Been pretty good from 15, 17 feet, and will shoot the open three if you give it to him.
Medford. That's Williams go by, then bounces it in to Gathers, and with the right hand, he scores. Gathers can hit that. That's basically indefensible.
He did
jump hook.
Yeah, and he did a great job doing his work early. Shepard had relaxed defensively, and that allowed Gathers to get that interior post position.
Both teams at 50%. Washburn a little bit long with the baseline jumper. Medford looking across, gives it to Freeman. He's got the open three.
And we talked about Medford coming on here, and that was case in point. And when you watch him, the game has slowed down for him this year. He simplified his playmaking, makes the singles and doubles.
Gets the steal there, feeds Wainwright. 9-4 Baylor, a 7-0 run for the Bears.
A complete team at both ends. And you mentioned Baylor in the past played a lot of zone. They can go man this year. They're balanced offensively, so it makes them tough to prepare for at both ends.
Shepard long with the 15-footer, kept alive. Parrish gives it up. Washburn down. Back to Parrish. Shoots a three.
Good look from Parrish. You want him taking that if you're Trent Johnson. He's coming off a 5-for-6 from three-point range performance against Texas on Saturday.
Gathers, no offensive foul. Able to get Shepard down to the court, but easily lays it in.
Mark, you know what's interesting about Baylor? They have three double-doubles Saturday at Iowa State, and Rico Gathers was not one of them.
Yeah, very quiet night for Rico. He played 15 minutes. Michael Williams making it a four-point game. Looked at the numbers for Gathers in those 15 minutes. 4 points, five rebounds. But the reason he didn't play that much, because of the way things were working offensively.
Well, you had Jonathan Motley with 27 and 13. And so he ends up playing 34 minutes. And he was playing so well. Scott Drew wisely kept him in the game.
Collins with an aggressive drive there to lay it in and pulls TCU within two.
And Collins is really key, not only tonight, but as the Big 12 season progresses for TCU. He's a really talented young man. He can shoot the three. Trent Johnson's trying to get him to do what you saw right there, drive it more to the basket and have a better mixture between the two.
Michael Williams gets fouled. We come to our first timeout, almost 6 minutes in, and a two-point lead for 22nd-ranked Baylor.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Phillips 66, proud sponsor of Big 12 basketball.
Well, we lost one of the legends in the broadcasting business today. Jim Simpson passed away at 88 after a short illness. Was at NBC for so many years, and then just after ESPN launched in 1979, he joined this network and in many ways legitimized ESPN. He was able to grab an accomplished play-by-play announcer like Jim Simpson in the early days of the network. One of the greatest ever, Jim Simpson. We pass along our condolences to his family. One of the true legends in this business. Back here in Waco, an 11-9 lead. After the foul, which was on Wainwright, by the way. Two fouls on Wainwright, so he's come out of the game. Vladimir Brodzianski's in there now for TCU, along with J.D. Miller. There's a long three from Collins.
I'm going to tell you what, I watched him in warm-ups. And that was from the top of the key, but on that right wing, he took several deep threes. And I didn't know how many he hit. I lost count at about eight in a row. But he looked good shooting it in pregame here tonight, and that was terrific, and you see the talent. We've seen him drive the basket in a broken four situation, and now you've seen him rise up and score from long distance.
5 points for Collins. Rodzianski called for the foul, and Frank Johnson in his fourth season now in Fort Worth, his 17th overall season as a head coach. Slowly continues to build this TCU program.
He does, and he lost the services of Kendrick Williams with the knee, and I'm telling you, that's a big loss because he very well would have been TCU's best player this year, certainly their most complete player. But they'll get him back next year, most likely get a red shirt. And so in the short run, that hurts him, but in the long run,
about 2 years left.
Yeah, absolutely. And sometimes those things can be a blessing in disguise.
TCU has followed a Baylor 7-0 run with a 7-0 run of their own to take a one-point lead. TCU showing that zone defense. Quick pass, deflected and stolen.
And on Saturday, Mastin and Motley, 27 minutes and 34 minutes respectively, and they were terrific. And they did some work high, low, and aims, but Mastin's got a face-up right there. Make sure it's a go before making that pass.
Collins over to Brodzianski with the dribble, scores. Well, there's a guy kind of the X factor. Was very good in the non-conference, but still feeling his way around conference play.
And it's because of the physical nature of the Big 12 conference. He is really skilled. I mean, he's a skilled forward, can pass, can score inside and out. And you saw right there the recovering ability to finish.
A couple of spin moves, and you see T.J. Mastin with the bucket. You mentioned 13 points. Just one off his career high when he came off the bench Saturday in Ames.
And what's great about him is he can catch at the high post and make plays, but he can also play with his back to the basket, which he illustrated right there.
Freshman J.D. Miller leans in. Tip, good. Brodzianski has 4 points.
You saw the mobility right there, Brodzianski.
Just rolls right off the tongue.
Yeah, I told you I was going to butcher that the first time.
Young man from Slovakia, Brodzianski. But how about the bucket here from Terry Mastin to stop the run for TCU? Coming up this Saturday at noon on ESPN, it's the Tobacco Road rivalry when North Carolina State meets number 5 North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Then at 2, these TCU Horned Frogs go to Allen Fieldhouse, take on Perry Ellis and still currently number 1 Kansas. Both games streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. You know, Allen Fieldhouse, arguably the toughest place to play in the Big 12. You hear about that with Hilton Coliseum, though Baylor the only team to win at Hilton Coliseum in the last 32 games played there. And I guess we're going to have to start throwing in the Coliseum in Morgantown this year. It's going to be one of the really tough venues to play in after what they did to Kansas.
Well, you and I have been out there. First of all, they have a tremendous student section.
Yes, no matter
what kind of year that they are having. But They're so difficult to play against anyway, but this year especially so.
Motley to catch and shoot off the inbounds. Baylor pulls within one.
And they would like to get him going offensively in this basketball game. You know, not just to get the point production, but to get some consistency out of him. Before his 27 points Saturday, he had not scored in double figures in six straight games. A lot of upside with him, a lot of potential, but consistency is needed.
A foul on the three-point shot to Collins, who apparently got banged in the head by a hand from Freeman. You have a TCU team that has scored on the last five possessions.
Just a little bit too much. The closeout was great, but you got to contest there without fouling. And because of the first deep three that he hit, you know, obviously Freeman's defensive awareness heightened where number one was.
Excellent free throw shooter, Chauncey Collins, best on the Frogs at 81%. It's the second. So this now is six consecutive possessions that TCU has scored, and that's a big deal, an early trend for them.
Well, they labored to score at times, and Collins, as of late, has helped with that. He had a career-high 22 games ago against West Virginia. You know, he really looks to shoot that three. Three-fourths of his shots come from three-point range, and Scott Drew understands that. But he's done a much better job, Mark Collins, getting to the foul line as of late. 33 times in the last five games.
15-4 run for TCU. They're up by four. Jake Lindsey now in the game. King McClure's also checked in, and the lob there to Jonathan Motley.
Obviously set up out of the TV timeout right there. You clear the weak side and you stretch out that ball screen.
Strong to the hoop. Washburn, nice move in the lane. They missed Chris Washburn, who had the broken finger on the non-shooting hand. They're now starting in his second straight game and his fifth overall game since returning.
The TCU's done a good job of getting just enough touches in that interior of the zone to keep Baylor honest, and they've produced.
Motley gave it up, and the short jumper hit by T.J. Maston.
Boy, they're working well together at that four and five spot. And right there, you see what's special about Baylor. It was this way that last year. It's the same this season. They share the ball as well as anybody in the Big 12 Conference. It just doesn't stick, and it's all five guys that make plays.
Williams hits his second three. And TCU continuing their offensive efficiency.
Well, Williams not known for point production. He's in there because he's solid and reliable. Trent Johnson knows exactly what he's going to get out of him. But that's what happens. When you have other guys step up and hit shots early, it's contagious to your teammates.
The shot clock at seven. In the lane, scoring is Maston with those long arms.
I'd say that Scott Drew is at a rapid pace developing some serious depth in the interior with the way Motley played recently, and then Maston. Boy, just a skilled guy again, can score multiple ways.
Well, the spin move by Miller, but he spun right into the double team there after the help defense came over. And Medford with a three. Bocianski pulling down the rebound.
Trent Johnson putting on the brakes here a little bit. TCU's done a good job so far reading tempo, but this needs to be a shortened game. They want to control pace. They want to minimize possessions if possible.
Back cut, Bocianski a miss. TCU had hit their last seven shots in a row prior to that. Medford throwing it back to Lindsey. Motley, defended by Washburn, backing him down into the lane. Lost it, able to get it back. Jumper from the baseline. Boy, Maston hit one from the left side, now hits one from the right.
And that was really good defense initially from Washburn. He is TCU's best interior post defender. But Baylor immediately gets the loose ball, and what do? They move it right off the bat, understanding that it's a broken floor situation.
Collins just a bit long with that three. Run out by King McClure, the freshman. Back to Medford. Screen set by Mastin. He rolls the jumper from the baseline. In and out. Tipped, last touched by Jonathan Motley. Timeout on the floor. TCU, though, with the one-point lead on the road over 22nd-ranked Baylor.
Now there's Collins right there. That's as well defended as you can do. Medford right there contesting. Collins has to fade away. But that's just a tough shot. Sometimes you just got to tip your hat to a guy like Collins. And he has come out tonight and really forced his will.
Shepard, but a foul underneath. And Washburn was knocked to the ground there in the lane. For that shot attempt from Shepard in the corners. King McClure goes to the bench.
Yeah, like I talked about earlier, Baylor developing some excellent depth at the four and five, but that is the strength of this TCU team. Trent Johnson doesn't worry about what he's going to get out of those guys. He's got enough pieces to go to. It's the guard play he's concerned about, but so far tonight, he has to be really pleased with what the backcourt has done.
Shepard got in some trouble, able to find Abram. Backed up by Collins. Abram was right there with Shepard. He's going to put up the shot. Bounces off and skying for the rebound. Rico gathers. Raymond feeding Motley. Turns, shoots off the rim. Offside rebound for Brandon Parrish.
And TCU, see, controlling pace right here. One of the things that they have done, even when they've taken quick shots or have had long rebounds, where Baylor could get out and get a little head of steam, TCU's done a great job of getting back in transition and stopping Baylor from getting to the rim.
Stealing it. Nicely done by Prince. A behind-the-back dribble to the rim with the left hand. Such a versatile player.
And he's one of those veteran guys in this league that's not only experienced, but knows how to play. He can score multiple ways. He's an excellent defender. He's just one of those guys that will affect the game in whatever way he can to help his team win.
Abram scores. Devontae Abram, the senior from Dallas, transfer from Arkansas. Back up to a four-point lead for TCU. The Frogs' largest lead has been five. Baylor had a quick seven-point lead early in this game.
And when you play Baylor, if you can get that ball to short corner and then have good decisions from there, you can get those type of looks.
Medford a miss. Boy, Motley went to save it. I think he didn't need to. I think it had gone off a TCU player. And here come the Frogs. Abram in the lane. Medford got a hand on it. The jumper's short. Brought out by Freeman. Prince. Three, Medford.
And that time, it's not Medford setting up a teammate, it's Prince. And as they advance the ball off the floor, you see Prince understanding there's a gap. And a long, quick first step, draws help and kicks.
Going to trap Shepard in the corner, but he finds Abram. Nice back cut and the pass finished by Brandon Parrish. But what a pretty pass by Abram.
Great interior passing from TCU so far tonight. And what I love, Mark, is when they've got those touches inside, whether it's been on the block or the short corner, you have cutters and movement away from the basketball.
And if you're just joining us, TCU without Malik Trent did not make the trip due to a violation of team rules. And he came in and has an average of 12 points per game. As bouncing around and in for Prince. And timeout called here by Baylor. So 3:29 to play in this first half. The TCU lead down to one. Morris floats it up. It's over.
The lob. Oh. The finish by Buddy Hield.
Medford, corner three. He scores. And he sank it.
Seldon having a huge night.
Well, look at the Big 12 headlines, of course, last night in Morgantown, West Virginia. Double-digit win over number one Kansas. Iowa State with their loss to Texas now just 1-3 in conference play. And Buddy Hield has 8 30-plus point games this year and, of course, a 40-plus point game in Lawrence. And he's second in the nation, about 27 per game. Well, here in Waco, under 3.5 minutes to play first half. And TCU with the one-point lead over 22nd-ranked Baylor.
And TCU has done the two main things that needed to happen early in this game to give them a chance. And number one, it's make shots as Collins about makes another three. They've done that. The second thing is ball security, curtail your turnovers. Only two turnovers for a team that leads the Big 12 in that category.
Bucket by Prince, and Baylor takes back the lead.
And it's not an accident that Prince is involved in just about every offensive play for Baylor right now. The senior understands when to step it up. And he's such a mismatch nightmare for several teams because of his versatility.
Prince again. Thinking about it. Defended by Washburn. Leifert was open. Dumps it underneath, reversed and scoring. TJ Maston. Maston 5 of 6 now from the field. He hit his first four shots tonight. And a timeout, TCU. So the Frogs use a timeout. They were up by 5 at one point. Now they trail it by 3. Two great NBA games on ESPN this week on NBA Friday, presented by State Farm. First at 7 Eastern, former Jayhawk Andrew Wiggins and the young T-Wolves are in Oklahoma City for a test with former Longhorn Kevin Durant, Russell Westbrook, and the Thunder. Then at 9:30, the Bron and the Cavs meet James Harden and the Rockets. Both games stream live on the ESPN app. We talked about Medford at the top of the show. Here's Prince creating another steal. Freeman. The contact and the foul that time on Michael Williams. Medford's doing what we expected, carrying over what he did in Ames when he had 11 assists, no turnovers in that one.
And he's been great ever since the Oregon game, which has been 13 games coming in. And he's just turned the basketball over 17 times. Now you're talking about a guy playing 30-plus minutes and your primary ball handler. In addition to that, he has 93 assists. That's a 5.5-to-1 assist to turnover ratio.
And so far tonight, 8 assists, no turnovers for him. And there's Maston again. What a first half he's having. That's a dozen first half points for TJ Maston.
And I mentioned that he has great feel, and that was case in point right there. He really understands when his back is to the basket on defenders, feeling that defender and understanding angles. That was a terrific flash right there and finish.
NATO run for Baylor. Washburn can't stop it there. Medford directed traffic. Now will peel to the wing. Three from the corner, wide open. Torian Prince with a minute to go. Just like that, Baylor has their largest lead of the night of 8 points.
And Medford again. The game has become slower right there, just letting whatever the defense gives and then taking it.
And TCU's gone cold here while Baylor's gotten hot and opened up an 8-point lead with an 11-0 run. contact there with J.D. Miller. Freshman picks up the foul.
Now here's the three, and Medford had flattened out the defense in transition. Nothing there to the basket. But movement as Prince just makes a cut along the baseline. He had Shepard on Medford because he put the pressure on TCU defensively in transition. And then the game, again, just comes so slow to him, and he just makes the correct decision. It's just not flashy every time. He makes things simple.
Baylor can hold it for the final shot here in this first half. Medford finds Bastin, who got pushed, no foul, but he scores, banking it in. 13-0 run for Baylor to end the first half, and they have a 10-point edge.
This team can score in a lot of ways. All led by Medford. Terrific run here down the stretch. Baylor has completely taken over the first half.
41-31 Baylor here at the intermission. And after the short break, Chris Hassel and Dan Dockich will join you from the studio for the halftime report. Go Texas.
At the
Brazos River. 10-point lead for 22nd-ranked Baylor. Along with Brendan Manser, I'm Mark Neely. When we talked with Scott Drew earlier today about Lester Medford, we asked, how's he gotten so good this year? And he said, well, maybe early in the year, he went for too many home run balls, a few too many mistakes. Drew told him, hey, the singles and the doubles are just fine. He's hit a lot of singles and doubles in this game.
That's exactly what he's done. And Coach Drew described him to a T here in the first half. He makes the simple play. Good point guards make correct decisions first and foremost. In transition, you saw him slow up. He let Wright fill the lane a little longer. And anytime he's penetrated, if you get in the correct spots, he'll find you. And then this last one is he's just letting the play develop. And his teammates, Torian French right there with the three, understand to continue to move because Medford will find you. He has 10 first half assists and just one turnover.
13, by the way, is a career high for assists in a game for Medford, so he's closing in on that. Baylor, by the way, hit their last seven shots of the first half and have a 10-point lead here at the intermission. Second half action from the Farrell Center just ahead. Just about ready for the start of the second half in the Farrell Center in Waco, Texas on Wednesday night. Hoops, 41-31 Baylor. Scott Drew's team 2-1 in conference play. They have not lost at home. They're 10-0 this year. When you go back to last year, they won 13 consecutive home games, which is tied for the second longest home winning streak in Baylor history. Her last home loss came 338 days ago, and it came to Oklahoma State back on February 9th of 2015. But very strong finish to the first half for Baylor, Brendan, as they hit their last seven shots. And a lot of that due to the distribution from Medford.
He gets everybody involved, but it really started, they started getting defensive stops. TCU, the shots were not falling like they were earlier in the game. And when they were taking long-range jumpers, you had some long rebounds that allowed Baylor to get out and run a little bit. It ignited the break, particularly when it's in Medford's hands. So TCU, needless to say, Mark, this first 3 or 4 minutes, they have to get a series of stops and stop the momentum that Baylor created offensively at the end of the first half.
Baylor has the ball to begin the second half. Medford feeding gathers. Fell down and a turnover. Williams brings it ahead.
I'm going to tell you right now, he fell down on his own because nobody is going to move him physically.
It would take a pretty good push to push down a man of that size. Rico gathers 6'8", 275 pounds.
And speaking of big guys, I hated to see Cam Ridley go down for Texas. I mean, having a great year. And obviously, Texas still trying to fill that void.
Wainwright
driving. And a foul underneath. How long gathers is his first.
Look at that Baylor lineup right now. I mean, you just have so many pieces that bring different things to the table. And Freeman, who fouled right there, shoots it. As we've talked about Medford all night, you have Wainwright, who's physical. Rico Gathers gets every rebound that's up there. And then you have Prince and his versatility. And one of the advantages Scott Drew has is he can take advantage of matchup opportunities within a game, most particularly with Tarian Prince.
Williams chased by Freeman again after a Shepherd screen. Washburn into the lane. Fires it up, but a miss and a rebound by Gathers. Medford directed traffic.
You see right there, small thing, but Collins has got to stop Medford higher up on the floor.
Gathers. And Baylor with their largest lead.
And here's the reason why. You have to get control of him early, even if you're sitting in the back of a zone. Because if he's able to get deep, they're able to start their offense deeper inside your defense. And it just took two little passes. They're inside the three-point line, which shortens the post-entry pass into a gather. So you got to pick him up high, try to get him under control, and make them run their offense out further.
Washburn, a pass for Shepherd. Trying to get around Gathers, and with the jump hook, does it before the shot clock expires. That ends a 15-0 run for Baylor, dating back to the end of the first half.
And I would continue to go to Shepherd, because one thing Gathers will do, he will play behind. And if you can catch him being a touch complacent, you get him deep enough, a Shepherd has the size to go over the top, over either shoulder.
And here's Prince. Freeman's got to put it up, and is fouled with two on the shot clock.
If you are not sound defensively, Baylor will make you pay. Shepherd right there was in position to help as Collins got hung up on Gather's body at that elbow. And then Shepherd late to rotate right there and help, and Freeman had the angle, gets himself to the line.
Foul was on Washburn, his first. Freeman, an excellent free throw shooter, 85% on the year. Plays 30 and a half minutes per game is the average, which is the most on the Baylor roster coming in. But there's a lot of guys there with their depth and flexibility there, Brendan, that play 25 up to 30 minutes.
Yeah, absolutely. And we haven't heard much from Freeman tonight. And he obviously is an excellent shooter, 43% from three. He can stretch out defenses. Get a good look at him right there. You know, this Baylor staff loves him because he may be the hardest worker on this team, which is saying a lot, because these guys have tremendous work ethic. But he is one that gets up a bunch of shots. And you can tell because his shooting has progressed.
Collins. Washburn, quick pass. There's Shepherd, a little fade away. Pushed out just enough that time, though, Brendan, what you were talking about. Washburn going for the steal. Kempton underneath, Gathers, reverses, and finishes.
Mark, Baylor's bigs do a great job of hiding along that baseline, the short corner. And then once Shepherd right there helped up the floor, that's when you get that simple bounce pass from the paint area down to those picks.
Brandon Parrish with the bucket. Yeah, Terry Mastin was excellent at doing that in the first half. We haven't seen him yet here in the second half, but he had 14 points, Mastin, which has already tied a career high for him.
And if anybody benefited from Medford's 10 first half assists, it was Mastin, but credit him. He knew exactly where to be.
It was an interesting long lob to the baseline, and a blocking foul going to go against Collins.
And watch Gathers. See, backs up. He backpedals. That's just smart basketball. And so Shepherd's caught in between helping on the drive or getting back. And What you should do is you should bluff at the driver and hope that they hold up just a little bit. Because if you're going to pick your poison, you'd rather that smaller guard have to shoot over your extended arm.
Thrown out of bounds. Nobody touched it, so Miller will now inbounds from that spot. A rare turnover for Medford tonight. Maybe a little miscommunication there on the inbounds. Freeman. Howard Williams all the way up the floor.
And for TCU to have a chance the second half, number 11, Brandon Parrish, he's got to get going.
Tough shot for Collins. It's long, but there on the offside, J.D. Miller in a double team. Tough angle there. Couldn't get it. Gathers had it. Lost it. Loose ball. Gathers able to collect it. And now they trap him in the corner. And they get a timeout. So a Baylor timeout. 47-35. 12-point lead for the Bears. Against Tulane on Sunday on ESPN3. And right now, unbeaten South Carolina early in their game with Alabama, currently on the SEC Network. Bama with the very early lead in that one. And that gentleman is going to do battle with that pizza, and I'm going to take him over the pizza. I don't think that's going to be a little one-sided.
I think he was saying, hey, hang on a second now.
Yeah, you want me to share
I will decide what happens with the rest of this.
Brent's guarded by Parrish. Medford, what a pass. But that time, Maston couldn't finish with the reverse.
What an important stretch for TCU. Right here. They've got to find some kind of offense at some point. Because you know Baylor, with their balance and all the ways that they can hurt you, they're going to put a couple of nice runs here in the second half, even against good defensive performances.
Shot blocked by Maston. One to shoot, got to put it up, got it off in time. And he hit the heel, missed by Parrish.
I'm going to tell you, I really like Maston. I think that he is going to be a tremendous player in this league.
Jonathan Motley.
Watch this defense right here. Maston stays down, uses his length. Baylor with another defensive stop in the lead.
Apple Hill, then at 2 Eastern, Perry Ellis, number 1 Kansas, number 1 for now. Play host to those same TCU Horned Frogs we're watching here tonight. That's at Allen Fieldhouse. Both games stream live on the ESPN app. Farrell Center in Waco, along with Brendan Manzer, on Mark Neely. 22nd ranked Baylor, front end of a 1-1, and
Mark, TCU, they have got to find a way to get the lid off the basket. You know, they had a 7 possession stretch in the first half where they got points offensively. Right now they're having a heavy drought. They've made 2 of the last 14 shots, and they're not a team that can play fast. And so, being down 14, they're going to have to make a move quick. And there's Coach Johnson. He's been in a coach of a year of the year in every league he's been in, with the exception of the Big 12 yet. He understands that they better make a move here pretty quick.
Well, that carry a few moments ago is just the 5th turnover committed tonight by TCU. That has been good mark for them. King McClure, this is a freshman, very highly recruited freshman, making his first mark of the night.
A good, strong, physical looking kid. I'm telling you, it's contagious. And anytime you get the ball at the high post, you want to look weak. And that's Maston right there, making the correct play from the high post area. And it was right on the money where McClure could catch and shoot in rhythm.
A stumbling Abram traveled. So that's back-to-back turnovers and six overall.
If you look back to the first half, Trent Johnson's team, when the ball was touched in the interior on the block like that, you and I were talking about the way they were cutting away from the ball. And they were getting looks at the basket because of that. That ball went into Abram. Nobody moved on the perimeter. Everybody just stood.
Lob there to Massey, who came back down with it. Bumped out of bounds, staying with Baylor.
And that's not Abram's strength. I mean, he's going to score with that body when he has angles. When it's an isolated one-on-one situation, you got to have a guard come over and help. And maybe he kicks it back out, and maybe he reestablishes post position. But you don't want to leave him hanging there on the block with nothing else to do but try to go make a play.
TCU had a 31-30 lead with 3.5 minutes left in the first half. Baylor's exploded since then, and they keep this alive after the offensive rebound for Motley.
And one of the things, too, to keep in mind with TCU, this is a young basketball team. Abram is the lone senior on this roster.
King McClure with another three. I mentioned he was a very highly recruited high school player, but was told his basketball career was over due to a heart condition in June of last year with HCM, which is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but they worked out a treatment and he's playing. He actually has a port in his heart where he plugs in every night to charge a device that helps him maintain his heart rhythm. You can only imagine how frightening, how disturbing, how upsetting that must have been. Here's a kid who's just about ready to go play Division I basketball, I'm sure, which has been a dream of his. And the medical profession says, nope, your basketball career is over. But fortunately, it has not ended.
And obviously, he wouldn't be out there if it wasn't safe. And that port allows him to compete at this level.
Stolen by Collins. Collins on the run, stripped from behind by King McClure. Motley looking and ahead of the pack, Mastin. Wow, that's athletic right there.
Boy, Mastin went high to get that one right there. That's a big time agility to not only go get it, but to come down under control and to finish.
But it's been high, 16 for him.
It's been King McClure here the last couple of minutes. Back-to-back trays. The freshman looking good. Well, back here in Waco, Texas, where Baylor has begun to distance themselves from TCU, much in part to Terry Mastin. The sophomore from DeSoto, Texas, has been terrific. 16 points on 8 of 10 shooting, and he's done it in every way an interior player could. High post, low block, going to open spaces. And Mark, on Saturday afternoon off the bench, it was sophomore Jonathan Motley with 27 and 13. Tonight it's Mastin doing his work.
JD Miller looking to complete the three-point play here for TCU, who in their previous six possessions had five missed shots, three turnovers, and settled for the 2 points that time down the floor. Lindsay kisses at it. Jake Lindsay, he's a freshman, son of former Baylor player and current Utah Jazz GM, Dennis Lindsay.
You know, and he hadn't played a bunch tonight, but he's a guy that if you've gotten some foul trouble and needed extra minutes out of him, as a freshman, Scott Drew can trust him. He's playing about 13 minutes a game. There's so many players on this team that assist to turnover ratio is really impressive. Lindsay, 41 assists and just 9 turnovers on the year, and obviously has that basketball heritage, and he plays like a guy that understands the game of basketball.
Grab there on Shepard, foul on the floor. When you look at Lindsay's high school numbers, went to Olympus High School in Salt Lake, and his dad, Dennis, the general manager of the NBA team in town, Jake set his high school's all-time assist record. Another foul and a grab on TCU. And the 16th foul of the half. That one on Washburn. His second.
Now, TCU has struggled offensively, but also what has been difficult, Mark, is without Trent, you've lost some depth on the perimeter, and it's affected them as much defensively as well.
Offensive foul that time to give the ball to TCU. Yeah, if you're just joining us, Malik Trent not here tonight for TCU. Did not make the trip due to a violation of team rules. Washburn. Almost a travel. They call the foul, though, on TJ Maston. That's the 17 foul and a 1-1 coming here for Chris Washburn.
And Washburn was huge against Texas on Saturday, the win in Fort Worth. And he missed the first 11 games with that finger injury. This is just his fifth game back, but he had 14-8 against the Longhorns. Quinn Johnson telling us today, and obviously telling us that. So we don't win that game without the way Washburn played.
That snapped an 11-game losing streak to Texas, which dated back to 1995 for TCU. Wainwright tied up. Well, it all began with an ill-advised pass from Wainwright, and he almost got it back, and then a little scrum on the floor. Foul will be the seventh team foul against TCU.
Hey, let's see what Tom Eads saw right here. It's over the back there, Mark. Not a ton of contact.
Front end hit by Wainwright, who hasn't shot a lot of free throws this year. It hit 8 of 10 on the season coming in.
Well, Wainwright, this is the first time I've seen Baylor in person this year. But it's evident in person his body transformation. Down from about 260 to 230.
High off the glass. And kissed in by Washburn.
Boy, nice move right there. Obviously able to go to that strong side, that left hand. Saw the good touch that Washburn has.
Lindsay spinning in the lane and some contact with Collins.
And for a freshman, and I mentioned his intellect as a basketball player, but right there, he understands. At 6'5", and Chauncey Collins, who goes 6 foot, and that's probably being generous. He's got a size advantage, so if he can just work his way deep into the lane, something positive could happen, and it certainly does, obviously, with him getting to the foul line.
Like Wainwright, another guy that hasn't shot a lot of foul free throws this year, but he's pretty good at it. He gathers, comes back in. Motley taking a seat. Lindsay came in at 41 assists, 9 turnovers. So he has about a 4.5-1 turnover ratio, assist to turnover. They just keep finding these really good ball handlers here in Waco. Scott Drew's done a nice job.
Yeah, just the numbers, the March numbers. Here the last handful of years, three sweet 16s in the last six seasons.
Prince with numbers. Had to force it up, but rebounded off the bounce by Lindsay. McClure is hit from long range. He drives, can't kiss it in. And the rebound falls in the arms of Kavar Shepherd. Washburn can't handle it. Out of bounds. to Baylor with 9:27 to go.
And it's really important for TCU to get the pace slower in Big 12 play. And if they get too far behind, as we alluded to earlier, then it forces them to play quicker than they're comfortable with.
They did a nice job early in the game controlling the pace, though.
They did. And you do that, obviously, by taking care of the ball, which they did. And then they made some shots. And the defense was good early. But I felt like once Baylor started getting going offensively, again, TCU, a young, inexperienced team, sometimes that deflates you. And you cannot allow those runs to deflate you, because you're going to play good people every night in this league. And they're going to put multiple runs within the game on your defense.
Three launched by Freeman. It's off the back rim. Long rebound run down by Avery. Under 9 minutes to go here in Waco.
You see, with the lack of depth on the perimeter, you've got J.D. Miller basically playing the three, which may be a good thing in the long run. They're really excited about him as a power forward, but he's playing more out on the floor here tonight.
Freeman fouled underneath by Abram. Saturday at noon on ESPN, the Tobacco Road rivalry, North Carolina State, North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Then at 2, Kansas and these TCU Horned Frogs from Allen Fieldhouse. Both games stream live on the ESPN app. Baylor in the bonus. Collins comes back in for TCU. ...65-39 Bears. Again, TCU had a 31-30 lead in this game with about 3.5 minutes to play in the first half. Baylor up to their largest lead of the night.
And the Bears close on a 13-0 run, and it happened fast.
There's a three short from Miller. Saved by Gathers, who tumbled over a photographer, threw it to midcourt. And there was Collins. Gathers back up and in the play. Brodzianski rolls around and rolled off. Wainwright going to get the rebound. Abram commits the foul.
Well, TCU just not able to get that lid off the basket. As you see, the only senior on this roster, Devontae Abram. Trent Johnson's challenge in a tough league with a young team is just to keep their spirits up, because they're going to beat some people. Saw that against Texas on Saturday, particularly in Fort Worth. And next year they got a chance to make a step up within this league. And so this is all these tough matchups here over January, February, March, Mark, are, I mean, you don't want to just discount the present, but this is a lot about the future. These guys learning how to play night in, night out in this league, particularly on the road.
After the 10th team foul, the two free throws, the last one missed, but off of TCU. So Baylor keeping possession. Shepherd's back for the Frogs, facing Brodzianski. Tipped out by TCU. And they're looking to win at home for the 14th consecutive time, dating back to last year. 10-0 at home so far this year.
And this is a team that their three losses have all come away from here against ranked teams.
And away from the ball, a foul in the lane. The hold committed by TCU. There's a timeout. 7:50 to go in Waco. 66-39 Baylor.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Phillips 66, proud sponsor of Big 12 basketball.
night, tipping off after Heat Clippers on ESPN and also streaming live on the ESPN app. Scott Drew's Baylor Bears ranked 22nd this week. Looking to improve to 13-3 and 3-1 in conference play, which would tie them with Kansas in second place in the conference, though Baylor's lone conference loss came in their conference opener to the Jayhawks. First free throw is good for Gathers. He has 9 points. You know, Rico Gathers has really improved his free throw shooting. Gathers has hit 40 now of his last 55. Now make it 41 of his last 56 free throws. So that's about 74-75% where he's been shooting in the 60 percentile prior to that.
Yeah, he's become much more than a big body that takes up space and goes and gets rebounds. I mean, they can throw it to him on the block. He doesn't have to have angles to score, although he's great at that. His shooting has improved. I mean, he's agile. His body transformed from his freshman to sophomore year. And you saw him dive for the ball out of bounds. That's the norm for him. Moves well. And gosh, every time you look at him, you know, you think it'd be nice to see him in the NFL as a tight end.
Yep, you bet.
I mean, with great hands and agile and huge. But he loves this game.
Rico Gathers, who joined the 1,000 career point club earlier this year, back in December, became the 29th Bear to be a member of that club. And he also has recently set the career rebounding record here at Baylor. And just prior to the game, they honored him with that mark.
You know, 1,000 career rebounds, and we're four games into the conference season.
He's got a ways to go.
He's got another 15 to, 19 games, depending on maybe more.
So he came in with 1,010 career rebounds. He broke Brian Skinner's school record, which was 915 rebounds, so he's obliterated that. And as you said, still has quite a bit of a season to play.
And Gathers is an example of why this league is great. Now, obviously, the Big 12, the last 2 years, has been the number one RPI league in the country and will be again this season.
Freeman from 15 around it in.
But the strength at the top is elevated. That's the difference. Now, the Big 12 is going to have to go prove it in March because they have not done that the last couple of years. I'd be surprised if they don't this season. But these veteran guys, Gathers, a prince for Baylor, Perry Ellis, those guys at Kansas, Buddy Hield returns, Isaiah Cousins, Ryan Spangler. That's why this league is so good. It's not just the talent level, it's the talent level combined with 3- and 4-year players.
Slipping, Freeman lost it to Shepard. That's a three put up and in by Kavar Shepard.
He's expanded that part of his game. A lot of work in the offseason as a junior to become more than just a low block player. And he's a guy that can make those. I think that's now 5 of 12 on the year. And most of those looks, number one, have to be wide open, but they got to be on a trail type play.
West Virginia with the win over Kansas last night leaves the Mountaineers as the only unbeaten 4-0, and they will have to play at Oklahoma on Saturday. So Oklahoma, if they are to become the number one team since KU lost, they have to play Bedlam tonight, and then West Virginia comes to town.
That's going to be an unbelievable game, obviously. But you know, one of the things about Bob Huggins' teams, particularly here in the last couple of years, those young guards, when you look at Javon Carter and Daxter Miles, and now their mouths got them in a little trouble against Kentucky last year heading into that game. But they will not go into Norman scared. They will give Oklahoma everything that they want. And they will totally go into that environment expecting to win. And the thing about West Virginia, Mark, they're just a couple of jumpers a game, or long-range shots a game, from going up another notch, in my opinion. Because they do not shoot it well from three-point range.
Yeah, they're 15-1 on the season, and there's jumper from the left side makes it a 73-47 game.
Last year they shot 31 from three. This year very similar. It's their work inside the arc has been better. It wasn't great last night, but yet they're still able to win because they get more looks at the basket through offensive rebounding, forcing turnovers, driving it to get themselves to the foul line.
A little battle underneath between Washburn and Baston, and a hold there on Washburn. Buddy Hield had a decision last offseason, come back or become eligible for the NBA draft, and I think he made the wise choice.
You look at those four guys right there, you could add several to that list. But no question, Buddy Hield made a great choice. But sometimes guys choose to come back and they're not better. And he is, and he was obviously a great player, last year's Big 12 Player of the Year. And he came back so that Oklahoma could have a chance to do something special as a team. But individually, Mark, it was to work on the ability to put it on the deck. And I think without question, he is better at that. And he's taking less than half of his shots from three-point range at quite a bit of clip, which is best in his career. What that tells me, just numbers-wise, he's putting on a four.
Very efficient.
And that plays off what his bread and butter is that ability to stroke that three.
What's going on with Iowa State right now? 1-3, that's the big surprise on the downside.
Their lack of depth. Seven-player rotation. I think there's fatigue there. But, Mark, you cannot give up 94 points in each of the last two games. And you don't have to understand or watch them play. You know they can score. But you've got to get to where you get some stops. And Baylor goes in there, scores 94. Texas scores 94. Granted, it was overtime, but that's still too many points when you're trying to be a championship-caliber team.
Blocked by Brodzianski. 4:11 to play. First block of the night for the Frogs. Put up by McClure. Tipped by Maston all the way back out to McClure. Tipped out of bounds by Miller. It's going to stay with Baylor with 19 on the shot clock. But we've slipped under 4 minutes. Baylor up big here on their home floor with under 4 minutes to go. Well, Saturday in Ames, Lester Mendez. Baylor had 11 assists, and he's had 11 assists so far tonight.
And he lets the game come to him, whether it's in transition, letting a teammate like Wright fill a lane, buying him time. And he's great in the half court, flattening the defense and making correct decisions. And Mark, notice none of those were necessarily eye-catching, just the right play executed at the right time. And there's recent point guards. And you want to talk about guys that can play here in recent years. Tweedy Carter, Pierre Jackson, Kenny Cherry, and now Lester Medford.
Three is short from McClure as the shot clock was expiring, but a foul grab of the jersey on Baylor. So 11 assists again tonight. And a senior from Tucson, Arizona, Lester Medford.
And he was a transfer last year. Got the transfer out of him. He didn't have to come in and run the show. He could play off the ball because you had a senior last year in Kenny Cherry, who not only was a solid point guard, you see Ish Wainwright go to the bench, solid point guard, but a tremendous leader. And so Medford was able to learn from Cherry. And what they've really done, Scott Drew, is just passed the baton down from point guard to point guard, because every time one of these guys has left, graduated their senior year, I've thought it. Well, what's their point guard play going to be like next year? Jared Jackson leaves, in comes Kenny Cherry. Kenny Cherry leaves, here's Lester Medford. But Scott Drew has done a wonderful job cultivating. And the one thing they all have in common, they all have different traits, but the one thing that's in common, they all can score too.
Yes.
So there's a great balance of being a playmaker and also scoring for your team as well.
Well, Medford's a senior, so he's a three that's put up. Austin Mills, who's a senior, a guy who came as a walk-on from the Pepperdine program, now on scholarship here with a chance to play. Medford's a senior, so let's look ahead to next year. Is the answer at point guard on the roster a year from now?
Absolutely. There's, you know, Lindsey would be a different type of point guard.
There's Schreiner, by the way. Lyric Schreiner, who's one of the freshman recruits for TCU, knocking down a three.
You know, Lindsey's a guy that, you see him with the ball right there. He's got size, vision. You want to talk about somebody who'll make the simple play. He'll do that.
King McClure. Freshman, 8 points. Boy, the bench scoring tonight for Baylor has been outstanding. 37 bench points now compared to 11 for TCU.
Yeah, that number gets high when Maston scores 17. Just like in Ames Saturday when Motley has 27 off the bench.
Austin Mills. Some playing time here. He feeds Maston. Misses with the left hand. Loose ball. Scoop back up by Lindsey. Spinning around, a little kiss off the glass from Motley. He has 10.
A soft touch right there. You know, he's starting to put on the right kind of weight and strength, too.
Miller with the jumper from 17 is too long. Quick timeout called here by Scott Drew just to get some more guys in the game, including John Hurd, a senior, a guy who was a student manager 3 years ago for Baylor.
Well, it doesn't get any easier for TCU, Mark. Got to go to Lawrence. Saturday, play a Jayhawk team that's coming off a loss. But they'll go up there and play hard. And again, they're going to win some games. And they're really a year away of making a move in this league. And I like their 3s, 4s, and 5s. I love J.D. Miller, the freshman. You know, Washburn's a guy that can play both ends of the floor. We've got some young guys that just got to get some experience. There's help on the way. And then you got a guy in Trent Johnson that's been through this multiple times at different programs. And he's been successful every place he's been.
Whether it's been Nevada, Stanford, LSU, you mentioned has won a coach of the year 3 times in all those leagues. He's won one, the SEC, what was then the Pac-10. And back to the days of the WAC for Nevada. Free throw missed by Mills, the second one, but he's going to get another chance with the lane violation. Well, Baylor has to go to Texas Tech this weekend, and with what we've seen from Tubby Smith's team, that's no easy chore now to go to Lubbock.
Yeah, and I was there Saturday night, and it was a 2-point game with Kansas with about 5.5 minutes left. Tech noticeably improved at both ends of the floor. They're better defensively. They're better offensively. Those freshmen are now sophomores. And particularly at home, they just play smarter. I mean, what you would expect when you're a year older.
Well, the crowd wanting John Hurd to get some points, and he just had that three knocked out of bounds.
Yeah, there's enough time here to get him another touch or two.
He has 6 total points on the season coming in, so Not looking for his first bucket of the year. Baylor will improve to 13-3 overall, 3-1 in conference. They'll stay unbeaten at home, 11-0 on the year, and it'll be 14 straight home wins dating back to last year. TCU will drop to 9-7 overall and 1-3 in conference play. 82-54, 22nd-ranked Baylor over TCU tonight.
What was that run at the end of the first half where Baylor goes 13-0 to end the first half, and Scott Drew's team took all the momentum, came out the second half, took care of business against a young TCU team who has better days ahead. But right now, Baylor playing very, very well here in the Big 12 Conference.
Well, the big night tonight for Baylor, and they win it 82-54. Coming up next on ESPN News at SportsCenter, for Brendan Manzer and our entire crew, I'm Mark Neely. Thanks for sharing this one with us. So long from Waco. Let's send you to SportsCenter.
All right, guys, thank you much.